relationship dissolution of parents, like that is considered, or you know, to be basically random, right? Like, hey, some people break up, some people don't.
Right.
And I'm, you know, increasingly suspicious. There is a systematic difference between same-sex relationships in terms of who breaks up and how often. I mean, there was a fascinating study just came out from the Netherlands just last month. They reveal that among these 2,900, 55% of children living with same-sex parents experienced parental separation. 55% right. of them.
Yeah.
Well above the 19% of opposite-sex parents who experienced the same. 55% versus 19% in the Netherlands, for crying out loud. Same story in Sweden, same story in the United States, same story in Canada. But, you know, it's almost considered in bad form to sort of bring this up, right? Because we're so used to controlling for disparate relationship outcomes. Right. When I think, you know, that's the pathway here.
That's exactly right.
It's the form that is more likely to break up, and breaking up is bad for kids.
Joyful, joyful, Lord, be adored, God of glory, Lord of God.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute, and welcome to this episode of the Dr. J Show. Today, I'm delighted to have my old friend, longtime friend, Dr. Mark Regnerus, as my guest. And we're going to talk with you about studies. I can remember many times over the past 10 or 15 years that somebody would write to me early in the morning and say, oh, Dr. Morse, there's a study. Have you seen this study? And I'd have to scamper around and find the study because the study, you know, might have said something that the person found surprising, like, lesbians make the best parents ever or something, you know? And so you'd have to go and read it and figure out what it's all about and does it really say that and so on and so forth. So I thought it would be fun for you all to listen to my friend, a sociologist, Dr. Mark Regnerus, so we can talk you through how some of these studies get done, how they are interpreted and how they're presented so that you can be a little bit better equipped when the next time you see one of these shocking headlines, that you don't flip out over it, right? That you don't, your adrenaline doesn't go all up. And you can look around for our work at the Ruth Institute or my friend, Dr. Regnerus. So Dr. Mark Regnerus, professor of sociology at University of Texas at Austin. Thanks so much for being with us today.
Always good to be with you, Jenny.
Yes, well, for those of you who aren't familiar with Dr. Regnerus' history, if you type him in Google search, you might find something about him being debunked and disgraced and so on and so forth, because in 2012, he had the nerve to publish a study on the impact of same-sex parenting on children. And he found it wasn't all hunky-dory. However, as a result of the uproar over that, he is probably the most thoroughly investigated academic in America. He has been thoroughly studied. And after all of that, he was promoted at the University of Texas. So I just want to say, if you see that in Google, just erase that, mentally erase that. And what you put in is the thoroughly vindicated Mark Regnerus. That's what you want to think when you think Mark Regnerus, the courageous Mark Regnerus. Dr. Mark, tell us, do you have any favorite studies right now that you think people should know about and have some help in reinterpreting?
Sure. Not so much a particular study, but I just finished an article under review now about how does it work that so many of these studies get published, and also that after you're reading them, you're definitely certain of what the authors think. But when you actually look at the data, you think there's a lot here that's missing that they didn't tell us about. So I'd be happy to sort of talk about that, and it can bleed over into some of the actual studies we have looked at.
So maybe the best way for most people to proceed would be for you to pick out one favorite study and then apply what your general insights to one particular study. And I know I have seen you've been doing this for years. You have a lot of it didn't take long for me to find three or four articles just in the last 2 years that you've written where you've been, you know, unpacking different studies. So
you got
a favorite? You got a favorite?
Do I have a favorite? That's a
maybe favorite's the wrong word, but you know what I mean. It's some result that you thought was promoted and presented in a particularly, what shall we say, manipulative manner?
Right. Well, yeah, we can go back and talk a little bit about the process by which people believed that my 2012 article was debunked somehow. That was an analysis by Simon Chen and Brian Powell, sociologists to whom I gave the data and who I actually even participated in the review process on the first round, first or second round, I forget. I think it was the first round. They were kind of over the top in terms of criticizing my study's conclusions that there was consistently distinctions between, significant differences between how the adult children of women who had been in a same-sex relationship fared in a variety of both past and present outcomes compared to kids who were from stably married mother and father households.
Yes.
Now, the thing that you know, that really stands out in that piece and that I've seen in other studies going forward is, first of all, there's typically not a commitment to sort of showing the baseline differences, right? I've seen this a lot in the National Longitudinal Lesbian Family Studies, where the baseline differences are overlooked, not presented, and you leap from table one, which is typically like, what kind of people do we have in this study? What percentage of them are female, male? What percentage of their parents are educated, not educated? Anyways, and then they leap from that to, not to the children's results, but to regression models with lots of different control variables. And all of a sudden, I feel like they have leaped well past what real life is actually about, right? And so what they do is, as I said in this article I just submitted, they lean on control variables rather than kind of describing the process by which this stuff happens. So the key thing here is, if you remember from that study, most people won't, but like 70% of the women who had been in a same-sex relationship, mothers in this case, with someone and who lived in the household with them, their child as an adult reported that 70% of them had received social welfare at some point while they were growing up, right? I use that as an outcome variable, noting that, like, wow, these families struggled, right? Cheng and Powell sort of turned that and like, oh, let's insert that as a independent variable, a predictor variable, alongside household income, which I already was controlling for. And so it was this process of how do we bleed these outcomes of, you know, technically speaking, variance, right? Like, so they said, okay, we're going to control for income and whether they had been on social welfare, right? Which is sort of a complete function of income.
Right. So those are two
measures
variables.
Of income, one of which was...
Those are two variables that are basically measuring the same sort of thing.
Correct.
And you're so putting them both in there at the same
time.
Right.
And one of them is true of 70% of the kids in this data set. So that means like you've already accounted for lots of differences.
Right.
Anyways, so there was that move. There was a move to sort of insert like household instability, which is another key thing that kind of breaks down these differences. And all of a sudden they say, after you account for the relative poverty that they experienced and the sort of household dissolution and relationship dissolution, after you control for those major deals, we see much less difference, right? It's sort of like, it convinces you that you can completely find what you want to as long as you just like keep adding variables until it goes away. This is actually, and I'm not accusing Powell and Cheng of this, there's a term called p-hacking. It's a statistical thing. But like that you can kind of trick a model until you get that P, that statistical significance, to where you want it, whether it's not significant or whether it is statistically significant.
Right.
Certainly, it's easier to bleed it of statistical significance if it exists.
Right.
Can't create it out of nothing.
Right.
But that's an approach that I think people take. I think it's duplicitous. I can't state that Chang and Powell did that.
Right.
But I see it a lot in these studies where there's a rush.
Hold on right here, because I want to tease this out for our typical listener. Okay, so you guys, you're tuned in to the Nerd Hour with Dr. Kay here, okay? And you see this, you can see this with, this is an old trick sexual revolutionaries have been doing. This was something that they tried to say about children of single parents and children of divorce, okay? So they would say, well, once you control for the amount of turnover in the relationship that, you know, we know it's better for kids to have stable relationships. We know it's better for them to have a lot of income. But what they refuse to face is that once a woman has a child with somebody she's not married to, her odds of having future instability in relationships are much higher, and her odds of having not very much money are much higher. Right. So to tease, to take those out and say, well, it'll all be okay as long as she's stable, as long as she's got money. Why don't we just give her more money and stop stigmatizing people and everything will be fine? And the kids, you know, I have talked to enough adult children of these kind of situations where they'll say, you know, Dr. Marsh, you're the first person who ever said that this is really hard, because, yeah, she had new boyfriends like all the time and it was awful, you know, and you start to go through the reality of what those correlations actually are, you know, and it's really not fair to say, well, it would all be great only if, you know, if only.
Sort of relationship dissolution of parents, like that is considered, to be basically random, right? Like, hey, some people break up, some people don't.
Right.
And I'm, you know, increasingly suspicious that, like, no, there is a systematic difference between same-sex relationships in terms of who breaks up and how often. I mean, there was a fascinating study that just came out from the Netherlands just last month in the American Sociological Review, top journal in the country. Lots of data, over 2,900 kids who came from same-sex households, mapping their academic progress. And that sort of story aside, when you investigate, like, what are they talking about here? They reveal that among these 2,900, 55% of children living with same-sex parents experienced parental separation. 55% of them.
Yeah.
Well above the 19% of opposite-sex parents who experienced the same. 55% versus 19%. In the Netherlands, for crying out loud. It's not going to get much more conducive, culturally conducive to same-sex relationships. But we can't really say, oh, this is a matter of stigma or minority stress.
Right.
Those theories don't really work nearly so well in the Netherlands. Same story in Sweden, same story in the United States, same story in Canada. But you know, it's almost considered in bad form to sort of bring this up, right? Because we're so used to controlling for disparate relationship outcomes. Right. When I think, you know, that's the pathway here.
That's exactly right.
It's the form that is more likely to break up, and breaking up is bad for kids. You know, like, what are you going to do? So. It feels like they get you coming or going.
And again, there's a parallel with the children of divorce. Back during the divorce revolution, parents were told, your children will be fine if you have enough money, if you never badmouth your other spouse, if you have harmonious divorce, a good divorce rather than a contentious divorce. And all of these kinds of conditions were put on. People understood themselves to be undertaking a decision that was not really very risky, right? But it was never explained until well after the fact that you go, well, criminy, this was a lot harder than I thought. I mean, I'm not bad-mouthing him, but he's bad-mouthing me, and I can't control that. And he's got a new girlfriend who doesn't really like my kids. And, you know, none of that was supposed to happen. And I think same-sex couples are being, well, I shouldn't even say same-sex couples, individuals are being led to select same-sex relationships thinking that they're relatively harmless, not realizing that there are, that there are all these hazards, you know, that could be known if somebody would just tell them, you know, if somebody would just say, well, you know, there is domestic violence in same-sex relationships. There is instability, you know, and whether it's more or less, it's still there, you know, so you can't assume all of that away as if it's, as if it's a control variable, like it's like it's your hair color or something. Yep. That's not really relevant. No, it's actually the pathway by which a lot of this happens.
I wrote about this in Cheap Sex a little bit, where you realize, like, the biggest deal that's going on in this kind of situation is not a function of orientation, but of sex, of gender, or whatever. That women are women no matter what their orientation. The same thing is true of men. So when you consolidate, when you double that in a relationship, when there's no complementarity and sexual difference, you are going to sort of highlight and magnify the kind of common distinctions that we see between the sexes.
Right.
And this was admitted with regard to same-sex relationships back in 2010 when Judy Stacy and Tim Biblars wrote their kind of famous piece on, you know, Everybody's Okay.
Right.
They noted, like, yeah, it's probably true that women will have a higher breakup rate and as a function of their higher expectations for relationships. Like, and I'm content to say, that's exactly right. That's what you have.
Right. And you have so more promiscuity. When you put two men together, you're going to have more extra partner sexual encounters.
Yeah. Right? Yeah, for sure. And then my colleagues will call that, you know, well, it's not really cheating because they're okay with it. So we've entered some strange territory where it's hard to figure out how you treat very different kinds of relationships. And so everybody wants to say, oh, this is all just another way of loving. Like, well, we've got three different ways now. The way that relationships between two women work, two men, and, you know, the rest of us.
Right, right. And but the point is that if the two men may be okay with having a lot of extra partners, but their kids might not be okay with it. The kind of impact that would have on a child may still be fully present, you know. And that's always that talk about an omitted variable. I mean, that's the big omitted variable right there.
The data, even though it improves, seems to suggest the same things, and yet the narrative is always spun in such a way that we move in a sort of a progressive, liberative family direction. And I think it's just masking some of the realities that kids endure.
In a way, the real meat of your study, actually there are many meaty parts to your study, but one of the things it showed is it was so hard to find a two women couple that was stable, that had in fact been stable over the whole lifetime of the child. And that by itself tells you that if you look at it from the child's perspective, child doesn't care about control variables. The child cares about the big picture of their life and what it's like. And so they really don't care about that. And you know, there was another thing that you talked about. Scientists have unwittingly revealed that the Obergefell decision did nothing to diminish sexual minority distress. So you know, there was a recent study that purported to show that surgery is beneficial for transgender children.
Yeah.
And I've talked with somebody else about this study, but I'd be interested to get your take on this as well. This is a study which later had to be corrected, shall we say. Because when you did a little more work on it, it turned out that the results that chased all over the world turned out not to be so stable or so robust. Do you remember that?
I do. Yeah. That study came out, I believe, late last year.
Yes.
And, I remember reading it and looking at it and thinking, okay, they're talking about a 0.92 odds ratio, right? Which is, at, you know, face value, that's not huge. There seemed to be a minor effect of surgery, not hormones. They already said hormones didn't seem to affect this at all, which I thought was valuable information.
Right.
By the way, this is a Swedish study. They practically do census of this stuff in Sweden. So it's excellent data, high quality. Right. But after reading it, I was like, the authors of this were just bound and determined to sort of locate an effect and then sort of highlight that effect as evidence that gender-affirming surgery mattered or helped, right? Mm-hmm. So like it's a minor effect, and I decided to apply this particular statistic to it called the NNT, the number needed to treat. A psychiatrist friend of mine said, hey, you should look at an NNT in this. Like, good idea. So we had enough information from the study itself to generate that, which found that you would have to treat 49 different patients with this series of surgeries before you should expect to see an additional one case improvement, meaning wow. The effect is so small that you have to treat a lot of people in order to get a benefit, right? Major costs, both in money and in risk to the person's body, to maybe see a slight dip in how often they use depressive services. And frankly, in the data itself, you saw that dip in the 10th year post-surgery. You didn't see it in the first, all the way. You saw a little bit in between, not much, but you saw a bigger dip in the 10th year. Now, some of the psychologist friends criticized this in part because it was like 10th year post-surgery. Like, you're talking about a completely different set of people who would have gotten this surgery 10 years ago. And oh, by the way, what happened to the people between 10 years and now, right? Some of them are attrition, lost to the study, potentially because of suicide.
Right.
So we had different sets of criticisms, both sort of saying, you know what? This study is making a mountain out of a molehill, and it's zipping around the world on the media, and all of a sudden, like, affirming massive surgical invasive treatments to generate the hope of a little bit less usage of psychological services down the road. I thought it was a real problem for the journal to have published that. And I thought it was a stretch for the authors to make a big deal of it.
Yes, and then they ultimately had to walk back that result because that when the data was reanalyzed, taking into account some of the criticisms, that even that result went away. And what they found finally was that it doesn't help at all.
Yeah.
Neither hormones nor surgery actually help.
So now one of the things that happens when this kind of situation occurs is you wonder, does the damage already done because the media narrative had already taken off?
Mm-hmm.
Is that like reversible? And I typically think no, right?
Right.
This happened several years ago when I discovered an error in a public health professor's analysis of general social survey data attached to the National Death Index, where he said we see that the average sexual minority person in the general social survey died on average 12 years sooner than other people if their neighborhood, or I think it might have been county, was considered anti-gay, right? Mm-hmm. In terms of the attitudes of other people around them who are taking the general social survey questions on that. And when I read that 5 years ago, I immediately thought, that can't be, right?
12 years?
That's too much.
Yeah.
So we acquired the data, analyzed it, couldn't find the same results, and re-ran our own study and said, we run this 10 different ways. We can't see it. And eventually he wound up saying, yeah, I made a mistake in coding, probably a graduate student, I'm not sure. But, and then that was that. And then I thought, you know what? You know, let's look at the citation index on this. His erroneous article that was still in print was generating citations well at a, 10 times the rate I was getting about my correction.
Right.
I thought this is a problem. And, the editors eventually did retract the study. So even after this correction, which is, you know, different, much less than a retraction, one wonders, you know, if the damage is already done.
Oh, and the thing is, too, if you add to that what is sometimes called confirmation bias, then it's really hard to undo. And what I mean by confirmation bias, people, is that people tend to glom on to results that affirm what they already think. Right. And so, you know, there are people watching this who are going to be glomming on to me and Mark because we already think that. We already agree with that. And the opposite, that it'll play out in the comments down here, I'm sure, you know, what people think. But the point is that when something has been, had to be walked back or had to be corrected or had to be moderated, there's already this cloud that favors a certain point of view that makes people more apt to receive the next time, you know, to be more favorably inclined to continue along that path. Yeah. And it has a tendency to snowball. So what I would say to you as viewers, is you need to come back here and check periodically and just see how many of these studies have had to be walked back, and see what some of the corrections look like, and then develop a healthy skepticism of the news media, which I know a lot of you already have a lot of skepticism about the news media, but also of certain quarters of academic life as well, that they do this and they get away with it. And if there weren't people like Dr. Regnerus and Father Sullins and Dr. Von Moll, if there weren't people like that watching, keeping an eye on it, this stuff would just go hog wild. And then people would be building their lives around this kind of misinformation. So, you know, Mark, another point that you made in another article that I saw, it's not about a particular study, but it was you reporting on an article that a colleague, maybe it was a colleague of yours or a friend of yours, I think it was called Queering the Data or Queering the Science or something like that. Does this ring in a bell? You know,
yeah,
what I'm
it does.
About? Yes, I want you to
fairly
talk.
Fairly fresh in memory.
I want you to tell people about that, what the article was, what the point was, just so people have an idea of what we're dealing with here.
And I wrote it after Lisa Lippman's experience at Brown. She was, I think she just left Brown, I think. She was studying what she had labeled rapid onset gender dysphoria because she was seeing clusters of teenagers, especially girls, kind of become gender dysphoric almost out of nowhere in packs or, you know, with among friends and in conjunction with spending a lot of time online, etc. And so one would think, like, if this was some very deeply rooted thing, that you shouldn't see clusters of teenagers do this when they had given no evidence of such prior to this time. So, you know, like somebody who wants to know what's going on, she conducted a survey of parents of these kids, trying to get her head around the problem, right? And that moved accordingly, and it was interesting conclusions published in the Public Library of Science 1 journal online. You can get it, open access. And so then it was published, her employer, Brown, the School of Public Health, issued a statement just sort of like, hey, this is a new study, et cetera. And then all of a sudden, you know, all hell broke loose really quickly. I call them, I forget the term. It's sort of like people with nothing on their hands but time getting onto the computer and sort of raking Brown over the coals, the journal, etc. And basically, you kind of create this scandal, or you create a sense of crisis quickly. And so then that gets Brown's attention, it gets the journal's attention, and immediately, like, these are historically, you know, these are high achieving people who are doing their job, and all of a sudden they think, people are angry at me. What did I do wrong, right? And so they kind of sort of like, oh, we've got to, you know, issue a statement. Brown's got to kind of say, hey, we were insensitive about talking about this study. the journal, class one, said, all right, we're going to re-review this study, which I was familiar with because it happened to me.
Right.
And I'm thinking, oh, this is insane, right? There is nothing wrong with her data. You may not like the data. You may criticize the methods, whatever. But she didn't convey anything that was erroneous, okay? Unlike some people who either make mistakes or blatantly hide things. So I said, you know, what's going on with science here, right? It's almost as if we have to have our findings, which are neutral in theory, cleared by a faceless group of internet-based critics before, you know, journal editors will be content with things. So, like, you know, and I feel for journal editors. Like, it's not an easy job. You do it for seemingly for the prestige, but nowadays in this domain, it seems like you get as much criticism as prestige.
Mm-hmm.
So I talked about in that First Things piece, it's almost as if there is a new set of peer review to it, right? Where the focus is how does this play among the LGBTQ community.
Anything that challenges heteronormativity.
Right. Okay. And meaning like, you know, the idea that to be heterosexual is somehow normative, right? So I'm thinking, all right, so now, we, you know, it's not enough to sort of describe social reality, which I've always felt like one of sociology's best gifts to the world. It definitely adds this sort of political element to the study of families.
I think you're right that that has been under the table or operating sub rosa for a while. And that's what you and Dr. Lisa Lippman tripped over. You know, you ran afoul of that peer review process that is screening out things that harm the narrative. Okay. I think what's at stake is that you and Dr. Lippman had the idea that you were trying to figure out what's real. You're trying to figure out reality. You're trying to understand the human condition, particularly as it pertains to families, these particular issues. But you care about reality, you have some respect for reality. The people you're dealing with do not like the world as it actually is. They hate reality and they're trying to change reality and not just tweak a policy here or there. You know, they're after things that are much more fundamental, like the relations between men and women, our relations with our own bodies, you know, how we perceive what it means to be a woman or what it means to be a man. Are we stable in our identity as a woman or our identity as a man? They're changing human nature. They're not just changing policy. They want to change human nature. And so therefore the truth will always be at war with them. You know, the truth gets escorted off the stage because it's not going to help them, you know? And I think that's what you, and I wanted you to tell people that somebody's actually coming out and saying this, because I think a lot of our viewers have that sense that this must be going on. What, you know, they're all like, what is happening? How can this even be happening?
Yeah.
This is how it's happening. And you're not crazy, people. If you think it's, you know, if you think there's something weird going on, you are correct.
Right. Yeah. There are days when I wonder like, how long do I keep doing this? Right. because you realize, the pathways into the social sciences, particularly in sociology, are fairly predictably progressive, right? When people complain like, oh, why aren't there any conservative professors? Well, they must not, you know, want to do that. Like, well, it's a little more complicated than that.
Yes.
Because you have to want to get in, meet the hurdles, pay your due respects to the in some ways, the false gods of this stuff. On your way to getting a job and then, you know, tenure and all that stuff. It's hard to know what's going on in the minds of some of my intellectual opponents. So I won't speculate, but I do know it's a perspective and an angle that's distinctive in some ways.
Well, and again, I'm going to go back to children of divorce, because there are plenty of people who have been through the experience of having their parents get divorced. And those people are now adults and they can speak for themselves, which, by the way, everybody, that was one of the strengths of Dr. Regnerus's 2012 study. He didn't ask the lesbian moms, oh, how are your kids doing? He didn't ask them that, which is what most of the other studies did. He asked the kids as adults who could speak for themselves, he asked them a bunch of objective questions. Did this ever happen to you? Did that ever happen to you? And he got their account of what had happened. So, but anyway, going back to the children of divorce, their pain over the breakup of their parents' marriage and the loss of the home that they knew, the upsetting of their life, that is very, very real to them. And you can paper that over with all sorts of studies and all sorts of what ifs and so on and so forth. But what they are left with, what those individuals are left with, is the sense that they don't matter, that their pain and their reality and what happened to them, nobody wants to hear about it, you know? And so when we show up and say, hello, divorce is actually hard on kids. I mean, I've had kids come up to me. I had a 20-year-old young lady at one of our ITAF conferences come up to me in tears. And she says, you are the first adult I have ever heard say that divorce is hard on kids. And she was in tears because her father was about to marry a 23-year-old, you know, somebody basically her age. Her father was getting married for the, I don't know, the nth time, whatever N would be, you know, and it was miserable for her. And yet we still have people, you know, kind of apologizing for divorce and saying, well, it'll all be okay. Although there is some consensus now that stability is a good thing, but that doesn't, it's amazing to me, Mark, you know, I kind of have the same kind of disconnect that you do. They're willing to say, oh, stability, instability is bad. And so if you account for instability, the gay thing is no longer a thing. But they're not willing to walk back and take that claim and say, you know what, therefore we need to reform our divorce laws to help people maintain some stability in their marriages. They never do that.
That's not going to happen, yeah.
The ratchet only turns one direction. You know, it never ratchets back. So, you know, one of the underlying themes that we keep coming back to is stability in relationship, that children need and crave stability in their parents' relationship. If you think about it, your parents' love for each other is the foundation of your whole life and the development of your personality. And we kind of know that that's important. We're kind of willing to admit that it's important, but then we're kind of not. So tell us how that shows up in different areas of study that you're aware of.
Yeah. So this article I just put under review highlights not just sort of the importance of relationship stability for kids, but talks about sort of how this is the linchpin probably for tracking their progress academically, psychologically, etc. And I continue to marvel at how social scientists of family are content to sort of background that conversation, content to sort of say, that's just randomly distributed, and we can't do anything about it, etc. And declare then, like, you know, there's just no differences between different kinds of orientations in how children fare. You know, as I said earlier, it's like you look at the Netherlands, you look at Sweden, like it doesn't get any more permissive than that. It doesn't get any more supportive than that. Mm-hmm. And you still see broad differences in the sort of the failure rates of relationships, same-sex relationships in these countries compared to opposite-sex relationships.
And the other place you see it, Mark, is the same sort of thing. If it's just about relationships, there is a thought in the sociology of the family that cohabiting and marriage shouldn't really be all that different. It's just relationship stability. But the fact is, cohabiting relationships are much less stable than marriages.
Yeah.
And that has implications. So it has implications.
And so for a while, that was sort of used to sort of promote the idea that same-sex marriage should be legal, etc. I mean, that has happened in most of these countries already. And yet we still see instability in one kind of marriage versus another kind of marriage, one kind of cohabitation, another kind of cohabitation. Yeah. So my job is just to sort of tell people what's going on, to call out you know, poor scientific conduct when I see it. You know, it's frustrating that in my study was described as debunked and me defamed when nothing about it was false.
Right. And in fact, that one table you have, the real killer table that you have, where you have the different family forms kind of all lined up next to each other, you know? And if you run your eyeball across that table, what you see is over here is mom and dad married to each other in a permanent relationship. And then you see one form of family breakdown after another. And what you see is the kids deteriorate, the conditions for children deteriorating as you go from one to the next, to the least stable. And so it's almost like that table vindicates a whole story. It's not just about gay couples. It vindicates the whole story, which I would say is the whole Christian story, right? Of one man, one woman for life as being normative. And it's normative for a reason. If the purpose of marriage is procreation, the purpose of parenthood is to bring up good kids and happy kids and well-adjusted kids, if that's what you're trying to get done, then get married, stay married. That actually is normative. That's the real world. And that's the reality that our colleagues in the social sciences don't want to embrace because it puts obligations on us as adults that we don't want to deal with. To me, that, you know, I hate to sound nasty about it, but I just think that's the bottom line right there. If we just blurt it out, you know, I'm going to do what I want, and you kids just have to put up with whatever I take, but with whatever I choose to give you, you know, if we just blurted it out like that, it would be really shameful. Right. But that is approximately what we're doing.
And if we took children's rights seriously, I think the way we understand some of the stuff would be profoundly different.
That's right. And that's what, as you know, that's what we try to do over here at the Ruth Institute, is to, you know, kind of connect those dots, you know, that if you started with the idea that kids are entitled to a relationship with their parents and say, well, what do we have to do to make that happen? You know, what would be conducive to that? Well, you know, mom and dad should probably have a stable relationship, hopefully before the child's even born. And then they should work with each other and they should collaborate with each other and they should only have sex with each other and not bring in other partners, because that is going to make it hard for the first kids to have a relationship with the dad who's off with the next parent. So just get married, have sex with the person you're married to. Don't get divorced unless somebody does something really awful. And don't pick at your spouse. Don't have nag and do all this petty criticism and stuff that we do. Well, if you do that, that's pretty much, you've repeated the Christian sexual ethic right there. And that last point of don't nag your spouse, that was always part of the Christian ethic too. I mean, I'm just saying. That was always right there.
It is good advice.
What's that?
That piece is good advice.
Literally in the Baltimore Catechism, what are the graces of the sacrament of marriage? To bear patiently with your spouse's faults. Literally listed as one of the graces. Well, you know, that's life. You know, your child, I guarantee you, everybody, your child's other parent will be a flawed human being. Don't know how I know that, but that's pretty solid empirical regularity, wouldn't you say, Mark?
I've met Rob. He's pretty good.
Yeah, he is. He's a good guy. And Deeann's good. Deeann's good too. So, okay, we'll kick them off the table. Anyway, well, Mark, do you have an institute or an organization or anything like that where people can connect with you on a regular basis?
Sure. I helped start the Austin Institute for the Study of Family and Culture. I'm not a staff, but I'm a fellow of the place. So they do good work, and you can find them at austin-institute.org. You can find my publications at my name, markregnerus.com, R-E-G-N-E-R-U-S. Or if you Google it and you screw it up, it'll probably correct it for you.
Yeah. And we try to highlight your work too whenever we're aware of something interesting that you've done, which is quite often that you do things interesting.
I'm tired.
And one more thing that I should tell everybody is that Dr. Mark Regnerus was the Ruth Institute Scholar of the Year for 2018. You were the very first person to whom we gave that award at what has become the Summit for Survivors.
I remember coming to Lake Charles before it might have changed this summer.
Well, yes, Lake Charles, the place, yes, Lake Charles has changed quite a little bit, actually. There's a lot of debris laying around the road, but it's all neatly stacked.
That's
so
good.
Therefore, when the second hurricane came through, it wasn't nearly as bad because everything in the trees had already been knocked down and was neatly stacked on the road. And so Delta was not nearly as bad as Laura, as it turns out. But anyway, you all can come back to Lake Charles anytime you want, Dr.
Happy to do it.
All right. Thanks so much for being my guest.
Yep. Thanks.
You've been listening to The Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.